Don't start.
Just no problem, that we can cut.
But where is it recorded?
It's got the screen and your audio. So once we finalize it, we can cut that video.
How are we going to use it? Oops. I have to be careful in what I say. And you have a caller mic?
Yeah. Some water is
okay. You guys will be here, some of you?
I'm
okay.
Here.
Check. Is it coming?
Okay.
Plus, these are also on, right?
Yeah, this one. Yeah, both on.
Right, when should I start?
But if you're doing it uniformly, all the pictures are available, then I should not be an exception.
Okay, welcome back after the break. Now we are actually starting the MOSFET, right? The most interesting device you have been waiting for. And for this, we have one of our best teacher, Professor Alok Datta, my colleague, but you know, I learned a lot from him. He will be talking all about MOSFET modeling in 3 sessions. So we have 1 today and 2 tomorrows. Okay. So Professor Datta.
Thanks, Yogesh. And welcome to this course. You all already had about 3-4 lectures, right? So with this lecture, we'll end today. Let's see how much we can continue today. This is on MOSFET modeling. Before I start the actual topic, let me tell you, this is a device which is field effect device, and it's a wonderful device because lots of things are there. And if your basics of MOSFET are strong, then obviously you can do any kind of research development of any novel device which are coming up into this technology. And I've tried to make the presentation very basic, not at a very high level, because I thought it is much more important to emphasize on basics. And if our basics are strong, then obviously we can pursue advanced research on advanced devices. At the same time, I would like to make this session interactive. You can ask me as many questions as possible. Some of them I may know the answer. Some of them I may not know the answer. Some of the questions I do not know the answer, I promise I'll come tomorrow with the answer. But make it interactive. It will make it much more interesting. I'll be asking a lot of questions, not to test your knowledge or anything for that matter, but just to keep you attentive. Interactiveness helps a lot in keeping viewers' attention and listeners' attention. A MOSFET, as the name stands for, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, which started in 1947. Shockley, this is a brief background. Shockley, Budden, Bratton, that time they developed bipolar theory, p-n junction theory, bipolar theory, and then MOSFET theory. Everything came together. Bipolar junction transistors came into picture almost instantly, but MOSFET went into hibernation for about 15 years. In 60s, Kang and Atala, these two famous gentlemen, first produced a MOSFET 6-transistor RAM cell, flip-flop. So that was the first IC, integrated circuit chip, which was fabricated using MOS technology. Anybody knows why it went back 13 years, 14 years before it saw the light of the day, even though it was kind of invented at the same time, like Shockley and Bratton said, AT&T Bell Telephone Laboratories, that like we have current-controlled action in bipolar, we can have voltage-controlled action in FET, field effect transistor. But still, it took 15 years for it to materialize. What was the problem? Very good. Very, 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 very good. Excellent. If you go like this, it will be wonderful. The answer is spontaneous, instantaneous, and absolutely correct. Interface. When you have silicon terminating to SiO2, lots of problem, because a crystalline material turning to an amorphous material, and the surface is extremely bad. And MOSFET is a surface device. So if surface is bad, what way it is bad, we'll be talking about that in great detail. At any point of time, if you feel that I'm going too fast or what I'm saying is not making any sense whatsoever, feel free to stop me and ask as many questions as possible. Okay, so let's make it interactive. Let's make it interesting. Then after 60, when the MOS technology evolved and the surface preparation became better, and they found that, yes, we can make MOSFETs and which will have reproducible operations. After that, there was no looking back. Slowly, the market share of bipolar kept on going down, down, down. And eventually, in just about 5 years back, it was 5% alone, that is bipolar, only 5%. 95% was captured by MOSFETs. And now almost 100%, I will say, unless you have very high-speed bipolar devices like ECL, some cases, emitter-coupled logic gates are still used. And there, of course, you have to use bipolar transistors, one of the fastest. The one problem of MOSFET was speed, but we have taken care of that to a large extent. Now gigahertz, hundreds of gigahertz or MOSFETs are routine, plus lots of novel devices are coming up, which can be very safely used in RF applications, 20 gigahertz beyond. Hundreds of gigahertz, that is what we're looking for. We start with basics, as the name stands for metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor MOSFET. As I said, I'll be starting with a very basic level, assuming that you have bare minimum background, and from there, let's build it up instead of starting at a very high level and losing the entire audience. That does not make any sense to me. Let's make it interactive. Some of these will be repeat for you. If you are in advanced standing, then some of these will be repeat. Doesn't hurt to listen to the things which you have already heard of. Again, doesn't matter, because no two persons present it same. So there will be some difference, some practical insight, and lots of stories I will tell you, because semiconductor device industry has undertaken lots of stories over the years. The metal typically started with aluminum, but problem was aluminum had a very low melting point, 673 degrees centigrade. And when they found that you're integrating more and more devices on the chip, then obviously I cannot have a single level of metallization. I have to go for multiple level metallization. When I have multiple level metallization, anybody knows how many level of metallization current technology supports? Vertical dimension, metal layer, insulator, metal layer, and like that it is building up vertically. Well, I'll take that, typically 7 to 13. Imagine that. So chips are actually becoming thicker than their, you know, lateral dimension. They are becoming almost like a cube, because the dimensions are not cube. I mean, that will be highly exaggerated. But when you have 7 to 13 levels of metal, obviously your vertical thickness of the chip is pretty high, and lateral dimensions also shrinking rapidly. When I was a student in mid 80s, that time minimum feature size was 10 micron. I'm talking about mid 80s. So roughly about 30 years have passed by. And in these 30 years, the minimum feature size has gone to 10 nanometer. Have mercy. From 10 micron to 10 nanometer, we have three orders of magnitude reduction. What made that possible? Photolithography. Different techniques of photolithography, minimum dimension. Welcome, Amish. He was a student here. I'm sitting here for a long, long, long time. Okay, so carry on. So then aluminum, they found they cannot use aluminum because of low melting point, plus aluminum had problem of forming alloy with silicon. So in year of contact, aluminum was problematic. So then they went to polysilicon. Polysilicon is polycrystalline silicon, which is not a good conductor. But metal, if it has to behave like a metal, it has to be equipotential. Metals, you know, cannot sustain diffusion current. So it has to be equipotential. And if it has to be equipotential, it has to have very high conductivity. Try to relate what I'm saying with the knowledge you have regarding basic physics. If it is equipotential and it should not sustain diffusion current, in that case, the metal should have, or the gate, I'm talking about gate material, should have very high conductivity. Polysilicon, unfortunately, doesn't have very high conductivity. Why? Polysilicon, polycrystalline, I think all of us know, polycrystalline silicon, clusters of silicon, between clusters, no symmetry, within cluster, high symmetry. And when you deposit silicon on top of insulator, I have talked about fabrication, so you must be knowing that when you deposit a semiconductor on top of an insulator, then obviously I end up with a polycrystalline structure, because the mother substrate is non-crystalline. When the mother substrate is non-crystalline, even though materials are falling on top of that, trying to form bonds, the bonds will be incoherent. And when the bonds are incoherent, I end up with a polycrystalline architecture. And I'm saying polycrystalline silicon is not a good conductor. Why? The answer you know, definitely. Polycrystalline, the name itself tells you it is not a crystal. So if I have a cluster, I have another cluster joined together. That line, wonderful, grain boundary, absolutely. I'll say nothing new, you will see everything you know. I'm just trying to tie up the threads which you already know to give you a bigger and better picture. That's all I'm trying to do. So this grain boundary, how does grain boundary affect carrier transport? Because low conductivity means low ease of motion of carriers. If the carriers move very easily, then obviously it has high conductivity like metal. But polycrystalline silicon is not having high conductivity means this grain boundary is doing something. What? They are creating something known as scattering centers. And these scattering centers will scatter the motion of electrons, creates an additional scattering mechanism and another scattering time constant, tau. And when scattering time is created by this grain boundary, obviously the mobility drops. I'll be telling all these things when the time comes here. But when the mobility drops, conductivity goes down. Then the poly gate will not behave like a true gate because it is not a metal. What do you do then? I have to artificially increase the conductivity because grain boundary is preventing my high conductance. It is giving a low conductance, which is not good. Polygate, as such, has very low conductivity. So increased conductivity, taking, say, louder. Exactly, very heavily doped, exactly. That is why you have N plus polygate, P plus polygate, sounds a bell. So this N plus polygate is very heavily doped N-type polygate, and P plus polygate is very heavily doped P-type polygate. Generally, the technology, what is done is when you dope the gate material, at the same time you open the source and drain windows and dope them also. Which means if you have an N-channel MOSFET, I assume you have basic background of MOSFET. If you have an N-channel MOSFET, it is P substrate. P substrate means I have N plus source drain. When I'm doing that, typically it is done by implant, no more diffusion, because diffusion is a problem of lateral spread, which IR must have said. So you do ion implantation, which is highly directional, and you use self-aligned technology by which you can flush your source and drain boundary with the gate edge. In that case, you don't have any overlap capacitance, which is detrimental for RF application, because if you have overlap capacitance, it is actually going to reduce your speed of operation by introduction of another time constant. Speed is okay? Making sense? Okay. Now, when you dope a polygate very heavily, then you are actually transforming it to a, something like a metallic state. And therefore, when you open the source drain implant or diffusion window, what have you, at the same time, you dope your polygate also. So there is a rule of thumb in technology that source drain type and the polygate type are same. It is extremely difficult for you to change it because it will need additional processing step. An additional processing step means more cost. You definitely do not want to make your chip more expensive. Then obviously your economics will suffer. It will not sell, as simple as that. So after polysilicon, they found it was not good enough. When the technology evolved, gate dimension reduced, and we are looking for better performance, the polysilicon gate was not good enough. Even though doped, very heavily doped, still its conductivity could not match that of a metal. What do you do then? You move to other material, exotic material, copper, tungsten, titanium, tantalum, etc. Very exotic materials, but they are tried out. Oxide, typically silicon dioxide is our oxide material, MOS, metal oxide semiconductor. Metal we talked about. Oxide is silicon dioxide. Initial few slides I'll take longer, obviously, because I have to build up the tempo. I have to build up that interest. I have to build up that basic background. Then we can proceed fast. Silicon dioxide is SiO2. Silicon nitride, Si3N4, another very precious material. In a sense, it has permittivity, epsilon R, relative permittivity 7. And silicon dioxide relative permittivity is 3.9. So if I compare Si3N4 and SiO2, I can clearly see there is a twice as much advantage in Si3N4. However, problem is Si3N4 is a very dense material and it stresses the underlying silicon a lot. It actually cracks it up completely. The interface gets severely damaged. So the silicon nitride has not been tried that much. And of course, right now, everybody talks about high-k dielectrics. Why it was necessitated, we'll talk about later. The most popular high-k dielectrics are HFO2 and tantalum oxide. Hafnium oxide, tantalum oxide. There is barium oxide also. Some ceramic material has been tried out. And since note that these dielectrics are HFO2, for example, doesn't have silicon in it, HFO2, hafnium oxide compound. That means when you have a silicon substrate, on top of that, you have this dielectric, you cannot grow it. Because when you have SiO2, you are actually using the mother silicon to make SiO2. But when you have HFO2, your mother silicon is not coming into picture. That means they cannot be grown. That means they have to be deposited. Problem again. Because when you deposit a dielectric on top of silicon, and obviously amorphous material sitting on a semiconductor, again, I have a problem of interface. Because the same problem I'm having coming back, deja vu. Because the problem why MOSFET went into hibernation is coming back with high-k dielectric. But high-k dielectric is frequently used. Almost all devices today have high-k dielectric. How is it possible? Say it again. Very good. Absolutely, 100%. Or what happens, we have to use something called a pad layer. And this pad layer is SiO2. You have a very thin oxide layer on top of silicon that takes care of the dangling bonds. Dangling bonds means surface bonds. I'll be talking about that. Then you deposit HFO2. Then basically you have a sandwich structure. You see that part of your dielectric is SiO2 and part of your dielectric is HFO2. So then they're in series. So you can all, of course, say 1 by C equal to 1 by C1 plus 1 by C2 and find the total capacitance. But you can never deposit high-k dielectric directly on bare silicon, just not done. So pad layer, thank you very much, absolutely correct. And then semiconductor, of course, universally silicon. Other materials have tried out. I'll be talking about that as we go on. More generic name, when it was coined by Shockley, that time he didn't call it MOSFET. He actually called it IGFET. IGFET name is very broad because it says insulated gate field effect transistor. That means he knew that gate has to be insulated. And the basic difference between FET and a BJT. BJT, I think all of you know, right? Bipolar junction transistor. Bipolar junction transistor, you have got emitter base collector. emitter current, base current, collector current. That is a current control device. Base current controls the transport between emitter and collector by charge control. Here, field of the gate, that is gate field, gate voltage, controls your transport. That is why it is called a field effect transistor. It is a foot, but IGFET name somehow didn't catch on because it is too big. So people preferred using MOSFET, and that name percolated, even though the metal is not really a metal anymore. It can be different types of heavily doped semiconductor can be used as metal. Oxide is definitely not oxide nowadays. Can be anything other than oxide, but it has to be insulated. What is the most important property of a good insulator, in your opinion? The answers can be hundreds, or not hundreds, several tens. But out of that, which one do you think is most important to you? When you're talking about MOSFET, when you talk about MOSFET technology and you're choosing an oxide, what parameter of the insulator is most critical to you? Interface, okay. Say, etching, that is technology, okay. I'm talking about electrical property, by the way. Okay, well, say it in another way. Say it another way. Low leakage current is because of? Okay, gate tunneling will be oxide thickness. Very good. Your answers are all absolutely right, because all these are important. You said leakage. I'm interested in that answer. How do you define an ideal insulator? Breakdown, did you say? Yes. Breakdown strength. Any idea what SiO2 breakdown strength is? We'll be playing with numbers in this presentation. No, it's incomplete. Breakdown strength will be some voltage divided by some distance. Well, your answers are of the ballpark. 10 megavolt per? Oh, I wish it was. Yeah, very close, but we have not reached 10 as of now. Quartzite, which is a polycrystalline SiO2. SiO2 or SiO bonds, because technology also plays a very big role in device modeling. Typically 10 megavolt per centimeter, some of the very refined oxides may have. But typically when you have quartzite, like when you have sand, sand is SiO2, right? Silica. But there is another type of silica known as quartz, which we in the chemical parlance we call quartzite. What is the difference, you know, between silica and quartzite? Because both are chemical symbol is SiO2. I will be telling you lots of, chutkis we call it, because these are things which I have taken for granted. But never bothered, why is it so? And I am more interested in this whys, because these whys open up new beautiful windows. And particularly when you're doing research on some new topology, new device, new transport, these kinds of chutkis help a lot in understanding the nuances of the things which you're doing. And when you do something knowing fully well what you're doing, it is beautiful. Believe me, when you have a feel of what research you're putting in and you know exactly why it is happening, instead of groping in the dark and not knowing really what these plots essentially mean, that is meaningless to me. That may produce lots of publications, but you will feel inherently void that I have done. I have, you know, presented material and I have published that paper, but I really do not know why it happened. That is to me is a big void. And that happens if your basics are not strong, if you're not tied up all the threads. I'm not preaching anything. I'm just trying to kindle that spirit in you, because I always tell my students, never take anything for granted, which I tell in class. Because the time you do that, your education is over. The time you think that the person sitting on the other side, whatever he is saying is Bible and we should, eyes closed, follow that, that's it. Question me. Question my authority of standing here. Do you know it, what you're talking about? And if you know it, tell me why. Some of the whys I still don't know. Some of the whys I know, because I explored and some teachers helped me when I was a student. But keep on asking why. This quartzite and silica I was talking about, their breakdown voltage is a factor of three different. You say only factor of three? Factor of three is large. Factor of three is not small. Your gate voltage can go from 5 volt to 15 volt if your breakdown strength is three times as much. Right? So you're talking about scaling of power supply. Three times. Three times in scaling power supply is not tiny. Do you admit? 5 to 15 volt or 5 to 1.5 volt, that's also a factor of three. For the same dielectric thickness, phenomena. Okay, the reason is when you have got anybody knows about tetrahedral bonding? Have you ever heard this term? What is the crystal structure of silicon? Okay, that is a unit cell. But the crystal structure? Diamond. Brilliant. Diamond. So diamond, when you have this diamond cube, it can be actually segregated into 8 such smaller cells. A cube, you can cut open. And 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 8 small cells. And 8 small cells, each of them create a tetrahedra. And this tetrahedra is repeated. What is tetrahedra? Tetrahedra is a triangular base pyramid. Median. At the median point, that is perpendicular from the vertex. You draw 3 perpendiculars. Long time back, we did in geometry. And they put an atom there. And that atom will be forming bonds with the 3 corner atoms at the base and 1 at the vertex. That is my tetrahedral bonding. Silicon forms that bond. Gallium arsenide forms that bond. Zinc blend. Remember, zinc blend, diamond. Zinc blend, when these atoms are different, the median atom is different from the corner atoms and the vertex atom, then it is zinc blend. All are same diamond. That is the difference between diamond and zinc blend. Both are diamond in terms of 2 SSC sublattices interpenetrating by 1/4 along the body diagonal. That's how we define a diamond lattice. Now, when you have that, then silicon dioxide clusters, or SiO clusters, also exactly same. SiO tetrahedra. That is, silicon sits in the middle, and there are 3 corner oxygen atoms at the base and 1 vertex. SiO4 complex, we call it. Now, when you have this SiO4 complex, then anybody knows the term short-term, short-range order and long-range order? Ever heard of it? Long-range order, short-range order. When you took first lesson of crystallography? No? Okay. Long-range order means, suppose you take a crystal, a perfectly oriented symmetric crystal, then if I take you to a lattice point, a particular lattice point. Lattice point means where atom is there. Close your eyes. First, I tell you to look at the surrounding very, very carefully. Take a snapshot in your memory. What do you see on all sides? Then blindfold you, lift you up and put you another in lattice point and open your eyes. Open that blindfold. And I see, look around. Tell me, are you in the same position or a different position? Beautiful riddle, Hena. What do you think? In a perfectly oriented crystal with absolutely no defects, I've lifted a person from position A, which is a lattice point, and put him to another position B, which is another lattice point. And the person has looked at the surrounding in A, and now I'm telling him in B, what kind of surrounding you see, and if this matching with the previous one, what do you think? If it is same, yes, same, could be a possibility. If it is same, then that structure has long range order. That is, I can go ad infinitum in all 3 directions and my symmetry will not break. With this, can you tell me which material has absolutely no order? Long range order means periodicity in all directions. On the opposite side of the coin is a material which has no order. Zero range order. Actually, zero range order physically does not exist, by the way. A long range order, short range order, ultra short range order. These are the 3 orders. This is important to understand polycrystal, that is quartzite and silica. That's how we started. Quartzite has a breakdown field of 3 to 5 megavolt per centimeter, 10 some of them may have. And silica has only 1 or even below. 0.8 megavolt per centimeter. Imagine 1 centimeter, how tiny. And that is supporting 0.8 megavolt to 10 megavolt. Just 1 centimeter. How good a dielectric it is, you just figure out. Silicon nitride is even better, but silicon nitride problem is stress. Anyway, coming back to this order. When you have silica has ultra short range order. That means these SiO clusters which form, after 1 or 2 clusters, the symmetry is broken completely. However, when you have small range order or short range order, that is observed in quartzite. In quartzite, this SiO cluster will repeat for a significant distance, but then they will rupture and have another symmetry starting. So when that happens, you are again something having a grain boundary between them. So these kind of, even though they're insulators, but they have crystalline structures. Unbelievable, but it is. Just look at Google, the quartzite structure, and it will show you this density of this SiO clusters and how they symmetrically orient over a distance. But that still be in microscopic scale, not comparable to crystals, which have a infinitely long symmetry. It may not happen in quartzite. So with that, we move on to this because I have digressed quite a bit. It is a four-terminal structure. You have drain, source, gate, and body. And keep on asking me questions if something I say, or you want to know more about something, I can elaborate. It is not a hard and fast rule that I have to finish my number of slides. That is a material to me. I have a given time period. Let's interact as much as possible. Make it lively. Make it a good interactive session. You have all my slides with you, I think, Johan has given you. So you can refer to that at your leisure time. If you know the basics, you can follow my slides very easily without any sweat. It is a field effect voltage control device. That is one of the difference between BJT, bipolar junction, and MOSFET. Unipolar, either electrons or holes contribute to current transport. Very significantly different from bipolar, where we have got electron and hole both contributing. Remember, majority carrier, minority carrier in bipolar. Here, it is a majority carrier device. I have either electrons or holes. Three basic modes of operation, accumulation, depletion, and inversion. I'll be covering very quickly what these modes are. Accumulation behavior is similar to a parallel plate capacitors, and it is used as something known as MOS capacitor, which we abbreviate as MOSCAP. A MOSFET can also be used as a capacitor. If I just use the device in accumulation mode means the surface is same type as the substrate, but with a higher concentration. That is accumulation. Accumulation of majority carriers. When I have minority carrier building up in the surface, that is called inversion. Brilliant. Absolutely super. So accumulation is MOSCAP. Then inversion for use as an amplifier. Whenever you want to have circuit application, capacitor also have circuit application. I'm not saying that in accumulation you cannot use it in a circuit, but it will be an overkill. But you can still use switch capacitor filters. Switch capacitor filters, all the capacitors are MOSCAPs. Compared to conventional capacitors, MOSCAPs have an advantage that they take much smaller area. And area is a premium in IC, obviously. So inversion for use as an amplifier in analog application or a switch in digital application, which is the most important mode of operation, inversion. While going from accumulation to inversion, it will pass through depletion. This is a structure which is a four-terminal architecture, S, D, G, and B. These are the four terminals. You have. I'll be talking about technology parameters. Keep in mind, because we'll be keeping on mentioning technology parameters. Technology parameters, what are they? What do they mean? Let's see. You have got a very simple cross-section where you have got, let me use this pointer, where you have got P-type substrate with a substrate doping concentration Na. Then this is my source diffusion, and this is my drain diffusion. And this is my oxide SiO2. And on top of that, you have a gate. So this is MOS with source and drain connected to it. And this is my body terminal. The difference between the source and drain diffusion edges is called channel length L. Here, channel length L is equal to gate length. The way I've drawn it, it need not be. It need not be. That is, the gate can have an overhang. It can extend on both sides. In that case, my gate length and channel length are not same. They're different by how much? What is that called? Suppose this gate had an overhang on two sides. It hangs over. Overlap capacitance, yes, that is overlap capacitance. But it is created due to what? That is what I'm asking. Lateral diffusion, you said? Yes, lateral diffusion. Lateral diffusion of source and drain. That is why people in small technology devices, they completely have thrown out diffusion. They say diffusion is a huge problem. We have to use ion implant. How does ion implant help, by the way, in reducing this lateral diffusion and making the, this is called self-aligned technology, the diagram which I have drawn, self-aligned. That is the gate, the two edges of the gate and the edges of source and drain are flushed with each other. Self-aligned. It is aligned self, automatically, by itself. How does ion implant achieve that? One is low temperature processing. Another one? Control the depth, yes. You are missing the most important point. High velocity, high energy, yes. Ions, yes. All answers are correct. But most important point is, I'm saying it totally avoids lateral spread. Because of what property? Ion implant is doping source. Ion implant is doping drain, but not let the atoms move sideways. Because of what feature? Depth. Depth is fine. Depth is fine. I'm not talking about vertical. I'm talking about lateral dimension. Because if spreads laterally, I have problem. Overlap capacitance will come in. My device will become sluggish. Slow. Huh? I have not put any voltage yet. I will put next slide, but now there is no voltage. What is the biggest property of ion implant which makes, it's common sense, I think all of you know that. Direction, 100%. Direction. The ion implant is highly directional. Ion implant is vertical. This is like, you know, you are throwing balls on sand. It is going and sticking there. How can it move laterally? That is the biggest advantage of ion implant, is directional. It is highly directional. And if it is directional, then the lateral spread will be minuscule. Not really true. There is a lateral spread also, because the problem is, now I'm going a little deeper. When you do ion implant, you're actually creating surface damage, because you're actually sandblasting something like that. Because the ions are coming and knocking silicon out and sitting there. So the surface area is becoming viscous, because atoms are going all helter-skelter. It is like truck, runaway truck moving through buildings and demolishing whatever comes on the way. Creates a lot of damage. And if it does so, then the device will be no good electrically. How do you take care of this issue? Say louder. Annealing, absolutely. What does annealing do? What does annealing do? What is annealing? What is annealing first? Yeah, you can have rapid thermal annealing, but normal annealing is raise the temperature, keep it for some time, and give enough activation energy to the atoms which have been displaced to go back to the lattice site. That is what is annealing. Typical temperature 600, 650. Typical time 2 to 8 hours, and you have perfect annealing. However, when you do so, some of these implanted atoms or ions, they will move laterally also. What is it called in ion implant parlance? Lateral diffusion is not zero in ion implant. If you think so, it is not quite right. Because ion implant also has lateral penetration, but it will be minuscule compared to diffusion. Diffusion, the lateral spread and the vertical depth can be even comparable, because it is like a tub, sphere. It is going here and here almost at the same rate. So you basically have a semicircle. That's what we have drawn here. But in ion implant, you will never have that. Your vertical depth will be always much greater than your lateral spread. Anyway, in ion implant parlance, it is called straggle. Anybody heard this before? Straggle. This is called straggle. Lateral straggle and vertical straggle. Vertical straggle is the delta difference beyond the depth at which it goes. See, this is another term I should explain in this plot. This is a P-type substrate, and your source and drain dopings are N+. Two important features I'll talk about now. Suppose I ground my source, I ground my body. Body is called substrate and back. This B terminal is called body terminal, back terminal, substrate terminal. Lots of names are given to that. And back bias, etc. You must be knowing threshold voltage change with back bias. That is my back terminal. Suppose I have a situation where I put my source to ground, drain to ground, body to ground, gate to ground, all tied to zero potential. Okay? I am trying to find what is the current flowing in this junction. First, do you identify it is a PN plus junction? PN plus junction has a name. What does N plus mean? Very heavily doped. So one side very heavily doped, one side moderate doped. That type of junctions are called one-sided. Absolutely. One-sided abduct step junction. If I have a one-sided abduct step junction, what is the important physical corollary? Depletion will penetrate primarily lower doped side. Brilliant. So my N plus region, the N plus region depletion width can be negligible as compared to here, the depletion in the P side. If I have these dopings are extremely high, N plus. Question is, how high can I dope? Number, because we are engineers, we'll be dealing with numbers all the time. 10 to the power? 90-20, absolutely. How do you arrive at that number? What happens if I dope it more heavily than that? Can I, first of all? What number told you, what logic told you it is 1920? Brilliant. Solid solubility. Another? Which actually determined the solid solubility? One step back. Yes, solid solubility is 100% correct answer. Solid solubility. Brilliant. I have a wonderful audience. Wonderful audience. But what determined the solid solubility? My God, absolutely. Atomic density. Yes. What is atomic density of silicon? Too many questions you ask. Why not? 10 to the power 22. See, you know all the answers. Does it make sense now? 10 to the power 20 doping? If I have 10 to the power 20 doping, how many silicon atoms I have to cover in the lattice to find one dopant? 100? 100 you said? I agree. 10 to the power 22 by 10 to the power 20 is 100. So every 100 silicon atom, one dopant is sitting there. Does it tell you that the dopants are spaced in the lattice, few and far between? Compared to 10 to the power 15 doping, I have to cover 10 million silicon atoms to get one dopant. Wow. Makes sense? Amazing. This is really, really amazing. Now, when you have this, the question I was asking, it is that, first of all, it is a PN junction here also. I'm asking you, what is the current flowing in this junction under the bias which I've given? Source at zero, drain at zero, body at zero, gate at zero. This is a very commonly misguiding question, by the way, because people get misguided very easily in this question. I get answers, nanoampere, picoampere, femtoampere. Nobody is quite sure exactly how much it is. The first hurdle we have crossed is a high-low junction. It's called high-low. One side very heavily doped, one-sided abrupt. The inside is much heavily doped. The question I'm asking has severe connotation, physical connotation. So you have to have very clear funda about this. I'm asking you a source body drain gate all are tied to zero. And I'm trying to measure the current flowing in that N plus P source body junction. There is source body junction, drain body junction. Either way, either one, I'm trying to measure how much current is flowing. What level of current I will see? Okay, answer didn't come. So let me probe a little deeper, go back. PN junction? See? That is what I thought. Picoampere, nanoampere, femtoampere. Anybody who doesn't quite like this answer? This diode is under zero bias. If the diode is zero, under zero bias, very common misconception. Don't feel bad if you don't have clear idea, because 99% will be a underestimate. 99.99999% will say femtoampere. So there is a very few who will say the current will be zero, because this is the PN junction which is under zero bias. How do I know it is under zero bias? Because my source and body both are tied to ground. This has very important connotation, particularly when you go to back bias. My source body junction under zero bias cannot carry any current. It is like you said, built-in potential is canceling something. Well, yes, I will say in another way, I will say the applied voltage is zero. If the applied voltage is zero, I'm still getting a current flow. Am I not violating thermodynamics? It is a perpetual motion machine. No energy input, energy output. How? Impossible. Is it obvious now that under this particular scenario I'm talking about, my operating point is at the origin? Diode curve, remember? I am right at the origin. How do I know that? Because my applied bias is zero. If it is forward biased, then my source body voltage, VSB, I call it, should be positive or negative? Negative, brilliant, brilliant. Because N side negative, P side positive is forward bias. Then this junction will start to carry a current. Same thing will happen in drain body junction. The MOSFET device is a surface device. Whatever happens should be here. Current should flow between source and drain, nowhere else. That means the current flowing here and current flowing here should be negligible for all circumstances. That means the first rule of thumb in MOS operation is my source body junction and drain body junction should always be reverse biased. Yes, that means under this parlance, can I say, follow me and see, think it is correct or not. I'm saying VBS and VBD. VBS is body source voltage and VBD is body drain voltage. Both got to be negative or zero, but not positive. But I'm saying that's not really true. I can still make it positive without much ado. Heaven will not fall on me if I make it positive. Do you agree? Think, because, you know, everything is in textbooks. There is nothing new I can do except, you know, increase your curiosity and your kindle the spirit of wise. I think that is much, much more entertaining than, you know, going through slides and iskabadi, you know, after this. I mean, this is highly boring to me. Rather, these interactive sessions are much, much more useful. Some of the things you will ask, I will not know the answer. No harm. Absolutely no issue. Because learning is a continuous process. Every day I learn something new when I walk into the class. There are still questions which I cannot answer. How does it matter? Nobody knows everything. I am saying that positive bias, VBS, and positive bias, VBD, is not a total taboo. I can still do it, provided I check something. What is that check? Just keep in mind it is a diode. And the diode current should not overbear or overpower or overwhelm the channel current. If I can keep that current to a very low level, forward bias, reverse bias, zero bias, doesn't matter. Agree? It should not affect my channel current by whatever means. My channel current should be independent. And the body current which is flowing should not alter my channel current by any means. Then if I forward bias and keep a check fully well what I'm doing, I'm in a perilous zone because I'm forward biasing my body source and body drain junction, let's say. If I do that and if I keep a check of what, that's what I'm asking, I can still be safe. Check of what? Gate is not coming into picture because it is a transport between body source, body drain, which are basically PN junction. I am taking two diodes in isolation. Very good. I will say not built-in potential. Because the typical, but you are in the right direction. Built-in potential is the key that you, the familiar equation all of you know by rote learning by heart, is kT by Q natural log NA ND by NI square. I mean, everybody knows it. Because some textbook has it, everybody else reproduced, and then, but people do not know under what condition that equation is valid. Anybody knows? That familiar equation, kT by Q, natural log NA into ND by NI square, built-in potential of a PN junction. That is not universally true. Of course, built-in potential is under thermal equilibrium. It is the device is not carrying any current. It is the contact potential. When you have two dissimilar material, to create equilibrium, I have to see so many inside things are coming up, which have kind of we have taken for granted. Without knowing fully well, some of us, without knowing fully well, why is it so? When two dissimilar materials join together, visually it will be coming in 2-3 slides later. I'm preempting it because whatever I'm doing are slides and some of the slides, but I'm kind of overreaching. Doesn't matter because it is like a storytelling anyway. So when you have a p-type layer and n-type layer in contact, first they are isolated and then now you make them in contact. What happens? Flow of carriers. Due to what? Diffusion gradient. Very, very good. Why are they moving? To do some what? To equilibrate the energy. Which energy? Fermi energy. What is Fermi energy? Average energy of electrons in system. I told you the whole snapshot of what happens. When two dissimilar metals connect together, there is a flow of carriers, and we envisage flow of electrons. Because electrons and holes both are carriers, but holes being an absence of electron or a vacant space, sometimes it is difficult to fathom what is hole motion. Hole motion is opposite to electron motion. And hole we take care of in valence band. And electrons we take care in conduction band. When electrons move, then I say I have a current transport taking place. But when you are joining two dissimilar materials without any bias applied, this flow of electron, first thing they do is equilibrate the energy of the system. When the energy of the system equilibrates, then I do not have any flow. There will be flow because of random thermal motion, but they will be exactly balancing each other, canceling each other. There will be no net flow. The net flow will take place until and unless that gradient exists. Remember, when you have diffusion of carriers in a p-n junction formation, a charged dipole builds up at the junction, and that charged dipole is made of ions, Nd plus on n side, Na minus on p side, and they start to build an electric field. And that electric field direction is such that it opposes carrier diffusion. That means I am a reverse process building up. And when this reverse process and the forward process balance each other, I have built-in potential. Built-in potential is the maximum forward bias you can apply to a diode. You cannot go beyond that. Because thermodynamically, it is impossible. Have you ever thought what will happen if your applied voltage approaches the built-in potential? Before that, this is very interesting because this has nothing to do with MOSFET, but this is basic funda of p-n junction. I think I can talk hours on p-n junction because I think p-n junction is a very critical element which you have neglected very much. And if I do not have a very good idea of p-n junction, then understanding all these devices will be very difficult because p-n junction is the heart of all basic devices. So if you have a very good idea about p-n junction transport, built-in potential, diffusion, capacitances, etc., current transport, then understanding any other device is a piece of cake. I strongly believe that. Once this contact potential builds up, the flow of carriers stop, and I have equilibrium established. What is the typical value of this built-in potential of a normal p-n junction diode in silicon? Can you tell me what is the maximum possible value? I take a p-n junction in silicon and try to measure its contact potential, which is also called built-in potential. And this built-in potential I'm trying to measure for a variety of diodes, p-n junction silicon diodes. Can it be anything under the sun? Or there is a limit beyond which it cannot be physically? Have you ever thought about it? What is the typical value you take when you do circuit analysis, for example? No, that is the knee voltage. Knee voltage plus 100 millivolt. The knee voltage is 0.6 for silicon, but we add 100 millivolt to that because we want to go to the flat spectrum or exponential spectrum. 0.8, yes, but I'm saying what is the maximum value of built-in potential? That is a magic number, by the way, for silicon. Built-in potential cannot be more than that. No way. Okay, forget about numbers. I take another material B, and I'm asking you another semiconductor B, some B, I do not know what B. And I'm telling you, if I make a diode out of that material B, what is the maximum contact potential? You don't have any number to fall back on, because the answer was correct, 1.1 you said, answer is correct. But how did you get that number? I think I got the answer. It is equal to the band gap energy divided by Q. It cannot be more than that. Silicon band gap is 1.12 eV at room temperature. Therefore, if I make a silicon p-n junction diode, the maximum built-in potential which I may get is 1.12. I will not get that because degeneracy effect will set in, and that will reduce my built-in potential because of heavy doping will reduce my band gap. That is a phenomenon called band gap narrowing effect because of heavy doping, which is called degeneracy. When you have degeneracy setting in a sample, then my built-in potential will go down. It will not be equal to the band gap. That is an advanced quantum mechanical effect because of electron wave function overlap between two adjacent doping atoms. Remember Boltzmann approximation? EC minus EF greater than 3 kT? and EF minus EV greater than 3 kT, then only I can use Boltzmann approximation. What difference does it make, Boltzmann approximation? Means if it does not follow Boltzmann approximation, then I can use, cannot use Boltzmann statistics anymore. I have to use Fermi-Dirac. Why that magic number 3 kT? Have you ever bothered? 3 kT at room temperature is how much? About 80 millivolt, milli electron volt. 26 is kT, 26 MeV, milli electron volt, times 3 is roughly 78. But why? What is so magic about 3 kT? Never thought about it? I say when you move closer than 3 kT, problem. Why 3 kT? Could 4, 10, 15, 100? No, 3 kT. Why? Okay, we'll come back to that when we talk about degeneracy. There was another thing which I wanted to talk about. I was talking about this PN junction. Oh, the maximum forward bias which you can apply. Okay, I'm drawing, since I don't have a board, I cannot do anything on screen or anything like that. I'm saying, remember the diode curve. Diode curve under forward bias. So if I plot ID, versus VD, diode voltage, forward bias, diode current, how will the plot look? It will be looking like flat, slash, slowly changing, and then zoops. Right? But even the furthest edge of that will be below the built-in potential. It can never quite reach built-in potential. Why? What will happen if I make a forward bias? I asked this question a few minutes back. If I make the forward bias approach the built-in potential, what happens? Applied bias under my control. I can put anything. Okay, let's trace back. Contact potential, which you said, built-in potential, let's say it is V0. Can I say it is my electron and hole barrier height? If electron needs to flow from P side to N side, it will face that barrier, or rather electrons rather, want to go from N side to P side, it will face that barrier. And if holes want to go from P side to N side, it will also face that barrier. This will come into picture in tunneling later on. So when you have this barrier height, that barrier height in equilibrium is equal to the built-in potential. Now I apply forward bias of V with a capital D suffix. And my built-in potential is V with a zero suffix. Now without any bias applied, VD equal to zero, my barrier height was V0. Follow me, because I'm chalking everything in air. Now I applied a forward bias, mind you, V with a capital D. What is my new barrier height? Okay, I got the answer. V0 minus VD, you said? 100%. That means my height is reducing. Remember thermionic emission? Current transport in PN junction is thermionic emission. It is transport over the barrier. Classical, no tunneling, classical. Electrons surmount the barrier, go to the other side. Holes surmount the barrier, go to the other side. Electron energy goes upward, hole energy goes downward. That is, if I go up in the band diagram, electron energy goes up. If I go down in the band diagram, hole energy goes up. Agree? So my new barrier height is V0 minus VD. I'm keeping on increasing my VD, my carrier injection also keeping on growing, and my current is blowing up. A point will come when V0 and VD are close to each other. That's what I said. When VD approaches V0, what happens? Yes. It is not really breakdown, but something very similar to that. Then the barrier height is vanishingly small. Louder. No, you said something which is correct. You say it again. No harm. I think I heard what you said, and you said it absolutely correct. Okay, barrier height is very tiny now because V0 and VD are very close to each other. Is it obvious the amount of carrier injection is out of the window? It is extremely large. That means the current flowing through the diode is extremely large. When the current flowing through the diode is extremely large, what will be the problem? It's good. The diode is carrying a lot of current. Heat, exactly. The diode will absolutely melt down. Smoke will come out of the device because of heavy forward biasing effect. I can never quite approach the built-in potential. It is a very simplistic picture, but largely true, correct, that we have a problem in a very heavily forward biasing APN junction diode because thermodynamically it is impossible. A very nice analogy was given by Streetman. I think all of you have grown reading Streetman devices from Streetman's book. Even I did that when I was a student in 80s. Streetman, Batman Banerjee was not there because Banerjee is almost my contemporary, Sanjay Banerjee of UT Austin. And right now, the edition which is there in the market is Sanjay Banerjee and Streetman. Banerjee and Streetman. But that time it was only Streetman. I'm talking about first edition because I'm talking about 80s when Streetman was working in Intel and he brought out that book. And he made a very famous statement that in case we could make, in the book it is there, I do not know with the fifth edition, I have not seen obviously, because in the process, I also wrote a book in 2008 after that I threw Streetman out. No, that joke. Streetman is still there very much. But Streetman made a statement that when you have your built-in potential and your applied voltage equal to each other, the analogy, listen to the analogy. He said, you are putting a bucket of boiling water and an ice slab next to each other and then taking the bucket away. Beautiful analogy. That means you have boiling water and ice slab next to each other. What will happen? Vigorous energy transport. And then when that happens, eventually you will get a blob of water which is at an equilibrium temperature, constant. That means if such a thing can happen thermodynamically, that I made my applied voltage equal to the built-in potential, I will not have a P-type material, N-type material, nothing like that. If I can prevent burning out because of very high current and very high temperature generation, if I can prevent that destruction or because it will destroy the device, if I can prevent that somehow, what will have a uniformly doped material? I will not have any P-type or N-type layer. So that is first thing to understand, that I never quite approach built-in potential. But people say that the built-in potential typically is 0.9 over 1 volt. It will be less than band gap energy because of degeneracy effect. But people keep on applying 1.2, 1.3 volt forward bias across a diode without the diode melting up. How is it possible? If you go to a lab and check, just take a diode and just apply a variable voltage across it and measure what is the diode current across the diode voltage and also keep measuring the temperature of the diode, you can go to 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, even 1.5 quite easily. After that, I cannot guarantee. But built-in potential is definitely less than 1.5. How did it happen? Okay. But that will balance with equilibrium. Contact potentials all have balanced out in equilibrium, by the way. That's what gave you V0, built-in potential. Because if you write the loop, the contact potential is always there. Very, very good answer. But that may not be the answer to this problem. Series resistance effect, absolutely. The diode is not the junction alone, but you have a neutral P and neutral N region. There is a resistance in that region, RP and RN. So the total voltage which you are applying across the diode is the drop across P, drop across N, and the junction voltage. The junction voltage cannot exceed the built-in potential, but the diode voltage is not the junction voltage. Are you getting what I'm saying? There are three components. One is P drop, N drop, and then the junction. When I said that the junction volt or that diode voltage cannot approach the built-in potential, I'm actually talking inherently about the junction voltage. So you can readily sustain diode voltage beyond the built-in potential because your series resistance will come into picture. This is Mother Nature's protection. And these resistive drops, which you have in the P and N region, will make the junction voltage always less than the applied voltage. For low current through the diode, these drops are inconsequential. So we can say whatever voltage I'm applying is appearing across the junction. But when the applied voltage increases, the current increases, the drop increases, then the applied voltage and the junction voltage start to differ. Nature's control, automatic protection. However, if you make it more than 1.5, then it will not be able to sustain. Because when you have a series IR drop, IRP and IRN, IRP is P drop, IRN is N drop, that drop itself is creating a joule heating in the P and N region. Because the current is flowing through a semiconductor means I have a heating problem. And this heating will destroy the device if this heat is uncontrollable. Final point, I was still not arrived at the answer which I was looking for, is if I forward bias this junction, what will happen as shifted this one? If I forward bias this junction, how much is the limit? Built-in potential is definitely not the answer, because then it will create huge current flow, which I cannot possibly sustain. It will be total disaster. You agree with that? So it should be something much lower than that. Can I quantify that? That is the problem. For that, you have to draw the diode curve in your mind and see that so long as the current is controllable to a small value, I can still apply that forward bias without much ado, without much problem. Question is, how much is that forward bias? For that, you have to do some engineering approximation. We always do that. Even when you are doing research, modeling work, anything like that, we always keep on making approximation, because the idea is to make the thing simple. From the diode curve, can I make it simple and say, if my forward bias is below that value, my diode current, even the forward biased, is inconsequential. How much is that voltage? Because there is a rule of thumb, by the way. I'm not saying anything esoteric or out of the world kind of a thing, because technologists use that all the time. There is an advantage if I can make my forward bias, closed body junction forward bias, because I can make my threshold go other way. I'll be showing that later. Because right now with back bias, threshold moves only in one direction. Go up, go up, go up. If I want to reduce below VTO, that is zero bias threshold, how do I do that? Forward bias. How much? That is the question. Tempo is built for the climax. Please say it. Diode curve. Just draw the diode curve and say what kind of engineering approximation will you make. And say, below this, I'm quite safe. Forward bias, but not enough current. Good. Very good. Very good. Now question is, what is cut-in voltage? If I know the diode curve, how do I know the cut-in voltage? Absolutely. Bullseye. Below cut-in voltage. How do you get cut-in voltage? What do you do? Absolutely fantastic. You said cut-in voltage, amazing answer. But after, if you know the diode curve, how do you extract cut-in voltage? No. If you know cut-in voltage, you know extraction also, obviously. You have plotted out your IV curve on a paper. Okay, you have an exponential line, which is increasing manifold. Just do a linear interpolation. Just do a linear interpolation where it cuts your V axis is your V gamma. In silicon, how much? Now quantify. Not 0.7. 0.7 is forward bias voltage. It is less than that by 100 millivolt, rule of thumb. Typical silicon diodes cut-in voltage is 0.6 volt. You said less than cut-in, I will play it safer. I will say not less than really cut-in, but I will say less than cut-in by 2. Fair enough. That is 0.3 volt. That is magic number. So I can still apply 0.3 volt forward bias in the source body junction and still be okay, because with 0.3 volt forward bias, the diode current, even the forward bias, will be negligible. Do you agree with this statement? V gamma is very close, because V gamma is a knee where the current is not really that low. If you don't understand, you just look at the diode curve. Diode curve, extraction of V gamma, and actual current in V gamma, and the actual current in V gamma by 2, you will see huge difference. So the magic number which technologists use and device engineers, circuit engineers use in MOS modeling and MOS circuit applications is, if you have to forward bias ever, you make sure that your forward bias is below 0.3 volt. V gamma by 2. Okay, so these are four technology parameters. One is channel length, L, channel width, W. I've told you lots of things which will occur later in slides also. So I've kind of covered those slides already. deoxys oxide thickness and NA substrate doping. This the device has gone through sea change. This ill I'm talking about, this channel length, which in 1980s was 10 micron, now it is tens of nanometer. 180 nanometer, my advisor, Pratul Ajmera in Alessio, lives in a state university. He used to tell that when I was a student, that time I was very interested in MOS modeling. Though I didn't work on MOS modeling, I worked on something completely different, defect characterization, because that was an army grant, which my advisor got. And I have no choice but to work on that. I'm not repenting that, but this area to me was more exciting. But unfortunately, there was no funding in that area. My advisor couldn't support me in that area. And he said, you have to work on defect characterization. I enjoyed what I did, but my heart was on this because I thought it was very fabulous because from very young age, I was very interested in physics. And I was to try to find out more details about why it is happening the way it is. And curiosity. Even today, I have a lot of curiosity about new things. And so this channel length L have gone by three orders of magnitude down. 180 nanometer is the node which actually caused a paradigm shift, which came about 5 years back, 180 nanometer, or maybe a little more, maybe 7 years back. 180 nanometer node was marketed. 180 nanometer, that time, there is something called process node. There is some, didn't I talk about process node, technology node, etc.? Because the topic before me was fabrication. Did he talk about technology node, process node, things like that? Did he? Little bit? Anyway, let me not elaborate because these are the nodes which now Global Foundry, TSMC, Intel and Samsung. These are the four big manufacturers. And right now, Samsung market share is very high because of memory effect. Because Samsung is selling memory like maniac. And that have pushed its turnover much higher than Intel. And when you went below 42 nanometer, maybe around 24, 25 nanometer, around that range, Global Foundry and TSMC also went out of the market. So right now it is a direct competition between Intel and Samsung. And Samsung is capturing the memory market and Intel is capturing the processor market. And that way they're actually complementing each other without, so they should not fight with each other and have a common minimum program. Then everything will benefit. This channel length is... Sorry. Even the slides are itching to go to the next one. Yeah. So N is channel length, W is channel width into the board, deox oxide thickness, and NA is substrate doping. These are the four parameters which are called technology parameters. Keep in mind, because I'll be using this term again and again, technology parameter, because these are under designer's control. A designer can choose its channel length, channel width, oxide thickness, substrate doping, everything they can choose. Operation accumulation gate is biased negatively with respect to substrate, if it's capacitor basically. So if it is biased negatively, holes will move towards surface obviously. And a P-type material, holes are majority carriers. Agree? So if holes are moving towards the surface concentration of holes will be more than that in substrate. Therefore, this region is called accumulation. Accumulation of majority carriers, by the way. Majority. The next one is depletion. Gate biased negatively with positively rather. With respect to source, and holes get repelled. Now, when you have a positive voltage to the gate, just remember capacitor. Easiest way to understand MOSFET is continuously have capacitor analogy in your head. Gate oxide metal, metal oxide semiconductor, gate oxide semiconductor, gate and semiconductor, two plates of the capacitor, and the oxide is a dielectric, that's it. And whenever you put a charge on the capacitor one plate, the opposite charge will induce on the other plate, that's simple as that. So when you have a negative voltage to the gate, positive charge will be at the surface, accumulation. When you have positive voltage to the gate, two things happen. Number one, first is hole will get repelled from surface. When you repel hole from surface, what happens? Near the surface region, the holes are repelled from what? Acceptor atoms. When you acceptor atom, hole is repelled, then it uncovers an ionized acceptor, which is negatively charged, Na minus. So first you create a negatively charged depletion region. Always remember, the fundamental principle of MOS operation is charge balance. Because charge can neither be created nor destroyed. Charge balance, each and every point of time, at each and every location, my total positive charge and total negative charge of the system must balance each other. If I don't have that, then I have a huge problem. Then I'm doing all trash. Because charge balance and potential balance, these are two fundamental equations, which will come in the next slide. Gate bias positively, holes get repelled from surface, leaving behind negatively charged ionized acceptor atom. These negatively charged acceptor ions, This is called depletion region. Yes. And eventually, with inversion takes place, with larger positive gate bias, electrons get attracted towards surface and creation of an inversion layer. This brings to another fantastic picture, which I, as a student, first asked my professor, that where do these electrons come from? And Ajmera, fortunately, was teaching that course, and he gave fabulous answers. And after that, of course, I didn't have to ask the question again. This is a p-type material, for heaven's sake. Hannah, in p-type material, electrons are minority. Very good. But they are limited. They are limited in number. That is, your answers are right. That is the biggest difference between a MOSCAP two-terminal. Two-terminal MOSCAP is gate and body. Four-terminal MOS structure is MOSFET. Basically, you take a MOSCAP, attach source drain, and you have a MOSFET. Your answer is absolutely right when you said that once the channel builds up, then source and drain can talk to the channel. Whatever charge balance is needed, they can supply. Another fantastic analogy, CVDs, another pioneer in MOS modeling, and CVDs, I was my mentor through emails when I was learning MOSFET myself. And some of you may have heard his name. CVDs is a pioneer, and I treat him as an absolute guru in MOS modeling. Moderate inversion, that particular topology was coined by him, and was moderate inversion region, because previously we had only two modes of operation, weak inversion, strong inversion. There was nothing in between. But CVD said, this has tremendous design lacuna. You cannot have that, because it cannot jump. Why? I'll tell you, everything is in slide. It cannot jump from weak to moderate, or weak to strong, just like that. I have to have a transition region in between, and he called it moderate inversion. This moderate inversion completely changed the design philosophy, completely. And this question, another question which bothered me when I was a student initially, was in a p-type substrate, I have a channel of electrons. Where do they come from in a two-terminal structure? In a four-terminal structure, I know source and drain can replenish. Another famous topological analogy which Sivadis gave, he said, on creation of a channel in a four-terminal MOSFET is akin to connecting two water reservoirs by pipe. Exactly. Nothing can be better than that. Your source is at a water reservoir, your drain is a water reservoir, and then you attach a pipe in between. That is exactly what is happening when you're having a channel formation. If you, the water level of the source reservoir and drain reservoir are same, the water flow in that pipe will be zero. Why? There is no gradient. That is VDS. Zero, no current. Tilt the reservoirs. Gush of water. What have I done? Applied VDS. When I've applied VDS, I've lowered the energy of that region where I applied positive voltage. Why? Why positive voltage leads to a reduction of energy? Sorry to ask this silly question, but it's absolutely trivial, no? Energy of electron equal to minus QV. That's why. So if I have a positive voltage, energy will go down. So if energy of the drain region goes down, electrons will rush from the source to the drain, through that pipeline. Current is flowing from drain to source. Done. That is my current transport. First create an inversion layer, that is a channel, then tilt by applying a voltage to the drain. If I apply positive voltage to the drain, VDS is greater than zero, then electrons will move from source to drain. Do you agree or not? Because it will go from higher energy to lower energy. And current will be opposite because electron is carrying negative charge. So if electron flowing left to right, current is flowing from right to left. That is my drain current. The strength of the channel or the thickness of the pipe, I can alter by gate voltage. Field effect. That is the field effect. Field effect operation. Voltage control. By changing the gate voltage, I can change the channel thickness, I can change the carrier concentration, but the continuity between source and drain will be always maintained. That is the same picture I see when I have MOSCAP. When I use a MOSFET as a MOSCAP, I use only gate and body terminal and ground source and drain both. Then there is a free flow because it will be because of random thermal motion. But due to charge balance, whatever carriers I need in the channel, my source and drain can always supply because it is a continuum. The energy is same across all over the place. So that these are the three distinct regions, but in the two terminal structure, this inversion channel creation is quite tricky because in two terminal structure, gate and body without source drain, I don't have that infinite supply of carriers. I don't. Therefore, I'll be limited in my CV response, capacitance voltage response. If the inversion channel cannot keep up, I'll have a different response. If inversion channel keeps up, I have a different response. It will be a function of frequency. It will be a function of bias. Lots of things will come into picture. Though I don't have MOSCAP because it is MOSFET modeling, but MOSCAP is a totally different. I can have another session on MOSCAP itself for two lectures complete because MOSCAP itself is a wonderful device. But here, you always said only talk about MOSFET. So it's fine because, but if you know clearly the MOSCAP operation, MOSFET operation is very, very easy to translate because one-to-one transformation is there. This is a band diagram. A little bit of band diagram is needed because I have to do MOSFET modeling. For MOSFET modeling, I need to define a few parameters. And one of the most important parameters is known as surface potential. So in this band diagram, I'm defining surface potential. If you have not seen this before, don't worry. This is the interface. I'll be explaining everything, which is a bare minimum. This is my silicon dioxide interface. My Fermi energy is constant. This is the depth. This is interface. So this is into the substrate. So I have taken the device and rotated it 90 degrees and looking into the substrate, how the energy bands change with position. One important feature I see is my Fermi level is constant. What does it imply? Another question comes to my mind about this Fermi level. I keep asking people, what is Fermi level? And I'll ask you also, what is EF? Yeah, that is the answer I always get. It is the probability of occupation of that state by an electron is half. So, exactly, very good. This is the average energy of electrons in the system. F of EF equal to half is a mathematical expression. It is 1 divided by 1 plus exponentially minus EF by KT. So whatever the value of T, when E equal to EF, F of EF always 1 by 2, 0.5. That means that particular state will be either occupied or empty. Because if the probability of occupation is 50, the probability of not occupied also is 50. So the state will be either occupied or empty with equal probability. That is my Fermi energy. But that is mathematical description. How do you define physical? Your answer is absolutely correct. When you said it is the average energy of electrons in the system. Now, if the Fermi level along the substrate is constant, EF is constant, that means the Fermi energy, which is a measure of the average energy of electrons in the system, is constant. So I'm asking, what is the physical fallout of that? Equilibrium. Very good. One step behind, which leads you to equilibrium. Before that, very good, very good. You are actually telling me n plus 1 statements, but I want the nth one. Average energy same, which means maybe it is too trivial for you. You said, I know all these things, so I am going to the last answer. Fine, no problem. But I love to go step by step so that I have clear concept of how things are happening. I'm saying if the average energy of electrons in the system is same with the depth, I cannot have any transport. Agree? All your answers are following that. If I don't have a transport, I don't have a current flow. If I don't have a current flow, the system is in equilibrium. No, channel. This is not channel. Channel is along this. This is into the depth. This is, I rotated 90 degrees. This diagram is rotated 90 degrees. Anti-clockwise. And then I'm plotting the surf energy diagram into the bulk. So that is why it is P-type substrate. I should have wrote an x-axis saying into the bulk. Maybe that would have helped a little bit. And so the parameters which are interesting for us are several. Number one is psi s. Psi s is known as surface potential, which is also known as, I'll do a little bit of that because without this, I cannot, because it is a MOS modeling course. If I do not do any mathematics, Yogesh will just kill me. So a little bit of mathematics I have to do. and that mathematics, but at the same time, I'll not push you, pull you off. Believe me, I'll not piss you off. I will try to do it as friendly way as possible. Do I know this is hated most by device physicists when they have to solve equations? But modeling without equations, well, I don't know. But bare minimum, promise. Huh? So what happens here is this is my interface. Parameter level is constant. EI is called intrinsic level. And another point comes to my mind. So many things come to my mind when I say that is why I digress so much. But nevertheless, these are very entertaining in a sense that lots of queries get answered at the same time. For me also, when I talk and you understand that, that means maybe I'm putting the physical picture correctly. And if you do not know it, for you also a revelation because you are a little deeper than you were before, which is good. So it's a win-win situation for all of us. What I'm saying is EI is referred to as intrinsic level, right? What does it mean? Because we have seen band diagram. If you have done any device course, you have seen band diagram. You know P-type material, EF goes below EI. You know N-type material, EF goes above EI. All these things are very well known to us. But what are these energy level EC? What is this energy level EV? And what is this energy level EI? Fermi energy, we know it is the average electron energy of the system. Fine. But what is EI? What is EC? What is EV? But another interesting point is when you draw a band diagram, then this is the band diagram, obviously. This one is y-axis, which is electron energy going up. What is the x-axis? From this diagram, it is obvious. But if I draw this diagram in isolation, just three parallel lines, and tell you what is the x-axis, what will you say? No, it is not momentum. It is not EK diagram. No. Distance. X-axis is distance. X. As simple as that. It is not momentum, please. It is not momentum. This is what, these are the answers I get. And there I get a little perturbed because this is not EK diagram. EK diagram is energy momentum diagram, which is very different. Energy momentum diagram is quantum mechanical. This diagram is classical. They are very, very different diagrams. Anyway, so this is energy versus position in the lattice. If I just have two, three parallel lines, EC, EF, EI, and nothing more, then my y-axis is electron energy and x-axis is distance in the lattice. Remember that. EK diagram will be valleys, parabola. They are the same K or different K, but let's not go to there. Then we'll be moving to Amit Verma must have talked about that today in the morning, EK diagram, because he's from physics background and he knows it, you know, fabulous. So what I was talking about, surface band bending, SIS. This is surface potential. It is also called surface band bending. No, the question was asking me what is EI. I think it is worth it to ponder a little bit. First of all, yes. First of all, let's understand what is the meaning of intrinsic material. Very good. You said two. I heard two answers. Number one, undoped. Number two, you said number of electrons and number holes are same. Agreed. Equal to Ni. Brilliant. How much for silicon? Will you ever stop asking questions? No. Because I think it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt. Because these numbers, we play all the time with it. I'm not saying that mug it up and, you know, rote learning. I hate rote learning. Learning should be fun. Learning should excite your inquisitiveness. That's all. Rest you will take care of. I'm nobody to preach you anything. But I'm saying just kindle the spirit of asking why. I think that will create wonders. You will see yourself. The moment you accept things, done, over. Keep on that, you know, fire alive, I've said all the time. Keep that fire alive of why. Some of the questions you know, some of the questions you do not know. Why? So let's ponder those questions. What was the question, by the way? I was asked, talking about EI. N equal to P equal to NI. I was asking, what is NI for silicon? Bapre, you have given the front coefficient also. I'm impressed. It is about 10 per centimeter cube would have been good enough. But you want to be politically and technically correct. And you said 1.5 times 10 is about 10, 100%. Absolutely. 10 is about 10, mind you. Compared to atomic density, 10 is about 22 per centimeter cube. It is a minuscule fraction. Agree? 12 orders of magnitude different. On what factor does NI depend on? Temperature. Temperature, very good. And the most important, band gap. Remember another famous semiconductor was there, germanium. Anybody remember historically we did germanium first and then moved to silicon. What was the band gap? Okay, 0.6 to 0.7, roughly in that range. Even numbers you know like this, Bapre. So what NI it gave? Higher than silicon or lower? Much higher, exponentially dependent. You guys are so smart. Yes. 10 to the power 13. Wrong factor, I'm trying to eliminate. 10 to the power 13, but it doesn't hurt to know the front factor also by heart. Brilliant. 10 to the power 13. See, 3 orders of magnitude difference. The band gap changed by only 0.4 electron volt, 0.7 to 1.1. And the NI dropped by 3 orders of magnitude, 10 to the power 13, 10 to the power 10. Another famous semiconductor all of us know of, gallium arsenide. EG, 1.42. And NI, 10 to the power 6. Look at that. Now, the million-dollar question. As the band gap is growing, my intrinsic concentration is decreasing exponentially. And out of the three semiconductors we talked about, gallium arsenide has least advantage or disadvantage. Very, very, common question. That NI reduction, is it good or bad? Because if I do not know that, to me, these numbers are mere numbers. You are not answering my question. I am saying, is it good or is it bad? First you tell me that, then we'll proceed. You cannot give explanation. Good. Oh, in some application it is bad? Which application? High temperature? For low NI or high NI? No, I am asking. Okay, I think we are mixing up answers. First, we have to understand the question clearly. I am moving from germanium, 0.67 EV and 10 to the power 13 per centimeter cube. To silicon, 1.11 EV or 1.12 EV, 10 to the power 10 per centimeter cube. To gallium arsenide, 1.42 EV and 10 to the power 6 per centimeter cube. As I'm moving higher in band gap, my NI is dropping. I'm asking, is it an advantage or disadvantage? You said it depends on application. I don't think so. Why should it depend on application? If you tell me solid reasoning, say, because of this, it depends on application. Because the answer you gave me, your answer is contradicting. Because you said with temperature, with doping, with temperature, my doping will be a problem. Will that occur for high NI or low NI? Number one, point it down in golden letters that lower NI is a blessing. Lower NI is a blessing because if you have an intrinsic semiconductor, I'm making a statement. Tell me if it's true or false. I'm saying intrinsic semiconductor is a perfect insulator. Do you agree? Almost. For germanium, it is not true. Because germanium, NI is 10 to the power 13. For silicon, 10 to the power 10, okay, still better than germanium. You said leakage. That I like that statement very much because that is what is driving force, leakage. Leakage means what? If I take an intrinsic material and apply a bias, my current should be inconsequential. If my current flow is measurable, even for intrinsic, it's no good. Throw it out. That is why when silicon came, germanium was immediately thrown out of the window. Nobody ever bothered. And it served so much before silicon came. Thankless world, really. But then from germanium, we moved to gallium arsenide. And silicon also was very apprehensive. It is going to say the last of his days, but not really, because gallium arsenide came with a lower value of NI because of higher value of EG, but it came with a lot of associated problems. What? No, whole mobility is comparable to silicon, 500 centimeters square volt second.
No, something different.
Okay. Biggest problem? All your answers are correct. I cannot say no. But why gallium arsenide, like silicon threw germanium out? Why couldn't gallium arsenide throw silicon out? Because gallium arsenide was all good. That's good. High electron mobility, faster device, higher current. Native oxide? Yes, native oxide. There are two huge problems with gallium arsenide. Based all our advantages. The biggest problem is one is arsenic and gallium have very different vapor pressure. And arsenic tends to evaporate from sample. Arsenic is a very toxic, flammable, explosive material. So you have problem of safety. That is number one. And second disadvantage of gallium arsenide is gallium is less, what do you say, active than arsenic. Arsenic always takes upper hand. Why? Because when gallium and arsenic form bond, gallium has a valency of 3. Arsenic has a valency of 5. Which means in the outer orbit of gallium, I have 3 electrons. Outer orbit of arsenic, I have 5 electrons. Since arsenic has more number of electrons, it always acts like big brother. The bond which they form, if you look at the total bond picture of gallium arsenide, you still have a filled shell. What does it mean? 8 electrons, 3 plus 5. However, this bonding is not covalent. Like silicon, silicon, 4, 4, 8, closed shell. But in that closed shell, 4 electrons belonging to silicon atom 1, 4 electrons belonging to silicon atom 2. But once they have formed bonds and across those two silicon atoms, 8 electrons are orbiting, then those electrons, if you ask them, which atom you belong to, which one is your parent? I don't know, I don't care. I'm in the group. But here, when you have gallium arsenic bonding with a total bonding of 8 electrons in the outer orbit, it is not covalent because it is actually Ga plus As minus formation. Gallium is positively charged, arsenic is negatively charged. Therefore, you may remember when you were taught about bonding, they said gallium arsenide does not have covalent bonding. It has ionic. It has actually polar bonding. It has part ionic, part covalent. It is not entirely ionic. It is not like sodium chloride. Like sodium chloride is another classic example of ionic bonding with group 1 and group 7 material. Remember? You know, bringing back old memories? This is the first picture of ionic bonding. Then came covalent bonding. Then came polar bonding or mixed bonding. Mixed bonding is partly covalent, partly ionic. This is the problem of gallium arsenide. Whenever you do oxidation, then arsenic being the dominant partner of this bonding, they will try to capture all electrons, all oxygen molecules. So what you have is GaAs, that is the chemical symbol of gallium arsenide. So when you do oxidation, you want to form Ga2O3 by valency requirement I'm talking about. Ga2O3, which is gallium oxide, and As2O3, arsenic oxide. And you want them stoichiometric. What does it mean? 1:1. You won't get that. Problem is, when you have Ga2O3, As2O3 formation under oxidation, As2O3 will supersede Ga2O3. When it does that and the oxide becomes non-stoichiometric, its electronic property is very different. It has high porosity, microstructure is very poor. When you have high porosity, immediately it's point to the fact its leakage will be high. Leakage high means its breakdown strength is very poor. Now imagine putting a dielectric on a MOSFET, which has a very low breakdown strength. Gone. Use of no practical use. That is why gallium arsenide MOSFET, you have never seen, you will never see. Because gallium arsenide does not have a stable oxide. It reminds me when I was a student in LSU, that time IBM gave a grant to LSU to try and find out if silicon dioxide can be deposited on gallium arsenide. Because silicon dioxide is a fantastic dielectric. And my boss backed the contract, and I was put as a tertiary project on that. And he said, just deposit, we had these evaporation machines. And you said evaporate, there are plasma deposition of SiO2. That time we had a good equipment. And he said, you deposit SiO2 on gallium arsenide and see how it looks. We have in situ SEM, scanning electron microscopy, which you see that layer of SiO2 growing on top of gallium arsenide. You can clearly see that layer by layer, it is a cloud is forming, and then a crisp picture of oxide layer on top. Because if I can do that, I have gallium arsenide MOSFET. And I'll be famous, along with my boss. Neva. Because when we took that out and did electrical characterization, there was no dielectric. So what the hell happened? We put it back to the ACM chamber, and gallium arsenide sample was showing crisp, nothing on top. We have seen it, sir. Believe me, we have seen it. A layer of 1 to 10 micron of oxide was deposited on top of that. Where did it go? Pertinent question. That you have grown 1 to 10 micron of oxide layer, SiO2, by plasma deposition on top of gallium arsenide layer. And ACM picture showed that. We had that snapshot. And it was showing beautiful 10 micron oxide on top of that. When you took it out from the deposition chamber, took it to the characterization chamber, and tried to deposit metal, we found the metal was directly on top of gallium arsenide. The dielectric layer disappeared. Where did it go? We found out that this was the famous analogy my boss gave. It was poetic, really. He said, oh, sand particles on wood. Yeah, it was exactly like sand particles on wood. Like you chalk dust. Some of your institutes may still have, I prefer board much more than this, because board is direct contact between student and me. When I write, they also write, and there's a direct one-to-one correspondence. When you do that, when you do, there's the chalk dust drops on the floor, and the sweeper comes, gone. Here, the same thing happened. The SiO2 plasma deposited on top of gallium arsenide never formed any bond with the mother. It was just like sand particles on wood. Just blow it, gone. So by the time we took it out from the deposition chamber and put it to the characterization chamber, that is the end of the project. Sorry, cannot be done. One line summary. But we didn't spend too much money on that, fortunately, because we found out that it cannot be done, and there is no point wasting time. And there are lots of material was tried out, lots and lots of dielectric. They just wanted a good bonding with gallium arsenide. Because gallium arsenide MOSFET has tremendous potential. Just compare electron mobility. 1200, 1400 for undoped, 600, 700 for doped silicon, centimeter-square per volt second. Electron mobility for gallium arsenide undoped, 9000 centimeter-square per volt second. With doping goes to around 1500, 2000. Huge difference. 4 to 6 times difference. Your question should be, going back fundamental, that if mobility is 4 to 6 times as much, why is it an advantage? By the way, I didn't tell you about the advantage of low NI. One advantage I told you is the leakage. There is another advantage. Keep this question in mind, what I asked right now, gallium arsenide. But let me go back. What is the second advantage of low NI? One is leakage low. So I have a low current, so which is definitely an advantage. But what is, there is another very big advantage. What is it? Huh? Wow, absolutely. Extrinsic range is very large. Extrinsic range means temperature range through which I can maintain extrinsic nature. What does it mean? That means I can dope and change the conductivity. And this conductivity change is not due to intrinsic. This conductivity change is due to doping. If my Ni is small, I have a wide range of extrinsic. That is why gallium arsenide has a very large extrinsic range. Thank you very much. That is absolute correct answer. So these are the two advantages of low Ni. I don't know any disadvantage, by the way, because low Ni definitely is an advantage. And gallium nitride has 3.4 EV. Its Ni is 10 to the minus 13, which is a novel TFET and all these things, HFET, high electron mobility transistor, HEMT. All these are GaN technology, which has a band gap of 3.4 EV.
And if you plug in on that equation, your Ni comes up to 10 to the power minus 13. Minus 13, mind you, not plus. Minus 13, minuscule. So if you want a high voltage breakdown, etc., very low leakage current, then nobody can beat gallium nitride. This brings to another very interesting scenario, stories and more stories. When I was a student that time, there was a classification of material taught by one of the professor, and he used to tell that 3 EV and below are semiconductors. And above 3 EV, it is insulator. And this definition hang around for so many years till gallium nitride came, because gallium nitride band gap is 3.4. How can you say above 3 insulator? Because gallium nitride hemp we are making. Oh, say, okay. Don't get angry. We'll push that limit to 5 EV. So now if you do material classification, they say till 5 EV, semiconductor, with tongue in cheek, of course, and above 5, insulator. Now maybe another diamond will come, 8 EV. And then you say, diamond as a semiconductor, people are trying for a long, long, long time. And when they come, they say, you say 5 EV is the boundary? No, 8.5. So like that, our yardstick is keeping on shifting with new material. That is why this area is so challenging. The chance of you getting outdated is just like that. It's very interesting. So many things happen. EI, coming back to that. But there was another question on gallium arsenide I asked. I'll be wrapping up in another 5-10 minutes. Another question I asked about gallium arsenide. What was that? I said, store this question. I'll come back to it. Oh, yeah, I was talking about this deposition. Yes, it just blew away. So then people tried various combination of different types of dielectric so that I can get a MOSFET out of it. That's what I'm looking for. High mobility of electrons will immediately translate to higher current. So if I do not want higher current, I can have the same current as before, but I can reduce my voltage, which means I can use the device for low power, low voltage application. Number one, this is a definite advantage if I can have gallium arsenide MOSFET. Second, if I have higher current for the same voltage, if I have higher current than silicon, I can charge my external capacitors quickly in digital domain. In analog domain, I can increase my bandwidth. That means I'm improving my speed. So if you improve speed and if you improve your current drive, then obviously advantage is advantage and advantage, more advantage. But unfortunately, Mother Nature and God has not given yet a gallium arsenide oxide. I am tempted to tell you to try it, but since people have tried for so many years and have failed, I do not know whether there is a thing to happen in gallium arsenide. I don't think Mother Nature will allow a new dielectric to be deposited on SiO2. And on gallium arsenide. So I don't have a gallium arsenide MOSFET. Does it mean the end of gallium arsenide? Absolutely not. Because I can always deposit metal on gallium arsenide and come up with MESFET. So when you talk about RF devices, nobody talks about anything else but gallium arsenide MESFET. Because gallium arsenide MESFET is a very, very high frequency device. And when you have RF application, then obviously that is the thing. Coming back to EI, intrinsic level. Intrinsic level is for undoped material. And then we digress so much. With this, maybe we'll wrap up today on this 4 equations. This is a good point to stop. And only 6 slides, but doesn't matter. Lots of future slides have already been taken care of, believe me. Later on, when I come tomorrow again at 10 o'clock, tomorrow you have two slots. One is from 10 to 11:30, I think, right? And another from 4 to 5:30. So twice we'll meet, we'll see how much we can do. And EI, with that we'll leave, and these 4 equations. EI is called intrinsic level. It is the material when I have doping equal to 0. Only intrinsic concentration. And you said, which I agree, that N equal to P equal to Ni. That is the definition of intrinsic semiconductor. If my number of electrons and number of holes in the system are equal, then my average energy of electrons in the system should lie mid gap. That is my intrinsic level. So intrinsic level is Fermi energy level for intrinsic semiconductor. Does it now explain why for n-type semiconductor EF moves above EI? And for p-type semiconductor EF moves below EI? This is a beautiful Fermi energy picture of doping. Because if I have an n-type material, do you agree my number of electrons outnumbered number of holes? If so, then my average energy of electrons in the system will be greater than that in intrinsic. So EF will depart from EI and move up. Similarly, for p-type material, electrons are fewer than holes. Therefore, average energy of electrons in the system will be lower than intrinsic. So it moves down. Brilliant picture. And it makes so much sense physically, you cannot possibly forget. So this picture of Fermi energy as the average energy of electrons in the system is much more prudent than the mathematical description of probability of occupation half. Mathematically, I cannot contest that because it is correct. But this definition of average energy of the system is much better. Any of you have known of Fermi sphere? Fermi sphere. If you have not heard of, doesn't matter. But Fermi sphere is total energy of the electrons in the system, particularly for metal. You can enclose in a three-dimensional isotropic body, which is called a Fermi sphere. And the energy, this is a E versus volume, kind of, energy versus volume. It is a spherical structure. And the spherical structure, the outer level is the Fermi energy. All the electrons of the system, in metal particularly, will be condensed within that. No electrons can go out. That is called Fermi sphere. And all metals are represented by Fermi sphere. Any solid-state physics book will have that. Last four definitions. Surface potential is band bending. And this is defined as EI bulk. EI bulk is here. Minus EI surface. EI surface is here. Divided by Q. Sign is very important. EI bulk is this one. EI surface is this one. Divided by Q. Equal to psi. Q is basically to track of unit. Because E is in energy. And psi is in voltage. So of course I got to divide by Coulomb charge. So electron volt divided by electron is volt, surface potential, which is also called surface band bending, total band bending at surface. And here, in this particular diagram, this is a sign, wrap up, oh yeah. I know, this is Johan Ismail. No, just a joke. So this, these are both, okay, it's already 5:40, let them go. Yeah, I know, you're also tired. So this psi s, total band bending, if I look at this diagram, psi s has a sign, by the way, obviously. Here psi s is positive or negative. Don't get offended because of these silly questions. Positive, obviously, because EI at bulk is greater than EI at surface. What happens if the band move up? Negative. Keep that in mind, because next slide tomorrow we'll be talking about that. EC, EI, and EV are bending symmetrically. That means if I know the band bending of one such band, only Fermi level is constant. Average energy of electrons in the system is constant. But EC, EI, EV following suit. Why? Very good. Absolutely. Because band gap is constant. EC minus EV, if they change with position, that means I am ending up with a different material. Do you agree? Because EC minus EV is band gap and EI is always at the center. Not really, but let's not talk about that. There's a slight departure from the center because of effective mass variation of electrons and holes. Let's not go into that detail because it's a common rule of thumb of taking EI at the center of the gap. We'll consider that. And EC minus EI and EI minus EV both are equal to EG by 2. Agree? Therefore, all three bands will follow each other. Therefore, whether you write EI here in this equation, you write EI or EC or EV, doesn't matter. Because all the band bending are identically equal to each other. Fine? Next point. IF is bulk potential. This is what is known as bulk potential. These are very important parameters. Extremely. With that, we'll end, as I said, these four. Out of these two are already known to you. IF is bulk potential. Bulk potential is the fun. I'll be talking about N-channel MOSFET. Because if you know N-channel MOSFET thoroughly, then P-channel MOSFET is a sign inversion and carrier inversion. That is, whenever your electrons change to holes, whenever your positive voltage changes to negative voltage, and you transfer an NMOS to PMOS. So I will not be doing simultaneously, because that is highly confusing. First, you master N-MOSFET completely and total control. After that, you can extend your knowledge to P-MOSFET without any sweat. Okay. So this bulk potential is called, and it is phi T. Phi T is thermal voltage, which is KT by Q. KT by Q has a magic number, 25.8 MeV, milli electron volt at room temperature, which engineers always round off to 26 milli electron volt at room temperature. And NI is intrinsic carrier concentration, which is 10 to the power 10. And of course, 1.5 is the front factor per cubic centimeter. and bulk potential is phi t, natural log Na by Ni. Na is a substrate doping concentration. Ni is intrinsic. Natural log of that multiplied by phi t is your potential of the bulk. We call it bulk potential. Just one point I wanted to mention. When I was talking about Ni. Oh, well, I was talking about Ni, yeah, with this we wrap up today. I said Ni is 1.5 10 to the power 10. I ask you, what is Ni? You said 1.5 10 to the power 10 centimeter cube. Agreed. I said, what is the value of Eg? 1.12 EV at room temperature. Agreed. But is this answer complete? No? Why not? Answer is correct. No, it is not complete. Why? Temperature. So I have to specify what temperature I am referring these numbers to. So these numbers are referred to P equal to 300 K, which is 27 degrees centigrade room temperature. Thank you very much for being a wonderful audience. I'll see you tomorrow again at 10 o'clock. Thank you. Can I take it out or do you have to first? No, you have to first.
Just wait for a few minutes.
You have to this. Which one you have to do?
Stop the recording?
No, not stop.
Okay.
This one, Akshay. Yeah. Done. So, do I have to bring this tomorrow, or I can use this? Thank you. You have this CAD lab tool now?
Which yeah, before leaving, yes. So serial numbers 1 to 40, 1 to 30, serial numbers 1 to 30 will be coming with us to the characterization lab, and serial numbers 1 to 50 still stay here, the rest can leave. We'll meet tomorrow. Serial number 1 to 50 just stay here, rest can leave. 1 to 50, 50. 1 to 50 stay here, the rest can leave. Okay, 1 to 50, just please open your laptops. All those who install the software on their laptops, please open them. If you don't have your laptop, you can...